Every call there is for full and unconditional surrender. That's what he's calling for, to borrow words from John MacArthur. When Jesus called people to follow him, he was not seeking companions to be his sidekicks or admirers whom he could entertain with miracles. He was calling people to yield completely and unreservedly to his lordship. And that's exactly right. A renunciation of self-rule and self-will is the only appropriate response to Jesus' call for disciples. We have to renounce ourself and our own will. That's what he's calling for. Now, someone hears all of that and says, yeah, but I thought we were justified by faith alone and saved by grace through faith, not by works. Isn't submission to the lordship of Christ a work? No, it's not. It is a fruit of genuine faith. In fact, one of the chief identifying marks of authentic trust in Christ is a conscious repudiation of our own sinful defiance. That's what repentance is all about. Jesus never gave a word of encouragement or reassurance to anyone who was half-hearted or lukewarm or lazy or lackadaisical when it came to the issue of discipleship. And Luke 9 records a series of incidents that give us a classic illustration of how Jesus treated would-be disciples who weren't really ready to take up their crosses and follow. Luke 9. So turn there. We'll focus mostly on this morning. Luke 9. This is the most important passage to turn to if you've just been listening along with the rest. Really turn to this one. Luke 9. We're going to look at verses 57 through 62. And here we meet a succession of three men who wanted to answer Christ's call to discipleship. One, verse 57, who was too quick to volunteer. Another, verse 59, who wanted to stall. And another, verse 61, who was too attached to his own home and possessions. We'll call them the guy who was too hasty, the guy who was too hesitant, and the guy who was too homebound. Because we have to have it alliterated, right? And I'll forewarn you, Jesus' response to each one of these would-be disciples is not calling people who want to mess around. And no half-hearted excuse will do with him. Let's just see what he was teaching here. First, notice the guy who was too hasty. Here's a man who, to all outward appearances, is quite eager to follow Christ. Over-eager, in fact. He's not counted the cost. He brashly approaches Christ and makes a promise he's not prepared to keep. Verse 57, as they were going along the road, someone said to him, I will follow you wherever you go. Jesus reminds him that discipleship would mean a life of extreme inconvenience. Verse 58, and Jesus said to him, foxes have holes and birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head. A life of obedience to the Lord doesn't guarantee a life of comfort and ease, regardless of what the charismatic guys on TV are telling you. In fact, more often than not, devotion to the Lord means the opposite. It means a life of trials and deprivation and persecution. This man used the right expression. I'll follow you wherever you go. That is the exact expression used in Revelation 14, verse 4, to describe the faithfulness of the 144,000. It is these who follow the Lamb wherever he goes. These have been redeemed from mankind as first fruits for God and the Lamb. So that is a fair description of what authentic faith looks like. It is a willingness to follow Christ wherever he goes, anywhere, even unto death. Like the heroes of faith described in Hebrews 11, verses 35 through 38. Some were tortured, refusing to accept release so that they might rise again to a better life. Others suffered mocking and flogging and even chains and imprisonment. They were stoned. They were sawn in two. They were killed with a sword. They went about in skins of sheep and goats, destitute, afflicted, mistreated, of whom the world was not worthy, wandering about in deserts and mountains and in dens and caves of the earth. And the writer of Hebrews goes on to point out that many of those saints, though commended through their faith, did not receive what was promised. In other words, in this earthly life, their heavenly reward will be great. They will receive what was promised. But the defining feature of their faith here on earth was a willingness to suffer for the Lord's sake. By definition, then, saving faith involves a willingness to suffer for Jesus' sake, to forego any convenience, to suffer anything, to go anywhere, all for Jesus' sake. This man in Luke 9 said he was willing to do that, but Jesus knew his heart, and the answer Jesus gives him lets us in on the fact that this man had not counted the cost of discipleship. This truth, by the way, is especially hard for people in our generation, in this age of convenience, to absorb. Our daily lives, compared to those of just our grandparents or our great-grandparents, our daily lives are unbelievably comfortable. Imagine life without air conditioning, without wall-to-wall carpeting, you know, without running hot water, without electrical appliances or automobiles or computers or iPhones or iPads or any of the other modern conveniences we now regard as necessities. People just a few generations ago had none of those things. And in fact, our own ancestors would probably have viewed them all as unimaginable luxuries. But we tend to think we're entitled to the best of life's comforts. And we spend major portions of our lives in pursuit of greater and greater ease. And if we're not careful, this becomes a serious impediment to our walk with Christ. Life's conveniences are a wonderful blessing. And there's certainly nothing wrong with thankfully accepting them as gracious gifts from God's own hand. In fact, we ought to bear in mind that we owe these things to the grace of God. We were born in a generation where things are so convenient for us. It is God who does that. According to 1 Timothy 6:17, God richly supplies us with all things to enjoy. Jesus' words to this overeager follower certainly don't mean that the comforts of life are inherently sinful. That's not the idea. There's nothing inherently superior in the spirituality of the ascetic who, you know, renounces material comforts and leads a life of deliberate austerity and self-deprivation. That doesn't earn you any points. But listen to all of 1 Timothy 6:17. Here's what Paul is writing. As for the rich in this present age, charge them not to be haughty, nor to set their hopes on the uncertainty of riches, but on God, who richly supplies us with all things to enjoy. It's a reminder that whatever benefits we enjoy in this life are fleeting and unreliable. And in fact, just 10 verses earlier, in 1 Timothy 6, verse 7, the apostle writes, "We brought nothing into the world, and we can take nothing out of the world. But if we have food and clothing, with these we should be content." Because as he says in verse 6, there is great gain in godliness with contentment. And the gain he's talking about there is the increase of our sanctification. It's not about ease and recreation. It's not about pleasures and self-indulgence or any of the other things that worldly people tend to associate with wealth. If you're wanting to follow Christ because you imagine that godliness is a means of gain, or if you think being a Christian means a life of automatic comfort and material prosperity, you won't be a follower for very long. Because true Christianity is ultimately not about affluence or convenience. Obedience to Christ will inevitably take you far outside the comfort zones of your life. Again, the way that leads to life itself is a small gate and a narrow way, Matthew 7:13-14, and all who desire to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. That's 2 Timothy 3:12. People who always want to choose the easy and convenient path are going to have a hard time here. So count the cost. That's what this guy wasn't doing. Now look at the second guy, the guy who was too hesitant. This second wannabe disciple appears on the scene, and this time it's Jesus who reaches out to him. Verse 59, to another he said, "Follow me." And the man replies with a request that at first glance sounds perfectly reasonable to most of us, but he said, "Lord, let me first go and bury my father." to our ears, it sounds like this guy's dad recently died, and all he wanted was a little time to bury the body. And if that were the case, Jesus' response would have been extremely severe. Verse 60, and Jesus said to him, "Leave the dead to bury their own dead, but as for you, go and proclaim the kingdom of God." Now, he's not being as harsh here as it might initially appear, because this guy was not saying that his father was already dead, or even that he expected him to die soon. This phrase, "until I bury my father," was a fairly common figure of speech that actually meant until I receive my inheritance. That's what he wanted. He wanted to wait until his dad died so that he could receive the portion of the family estate that was coming to him, and then he said he would be a disciple. And Jesus makes it clear that there's just no room for that kind of double-mindedness if someone wants to follow him. He who hesitates cannot be a disciple. He who wants to delay and make excuses isn't fit for the kingdom. And so he rebukes this guy. Now, a third candidate for discipleship steps forward. We've had one who was too hasty, one who was too hesitant. Here's a third would-be disciple, the guy who was too homebound. Verse 61, yet another said, "I will follow you, Lord, but let me first say farewell to those at home." Now, how could that not be a reasonable request? All he asks for is an opportunity to say goodbye to his family. That certainly sounds like a reasonable request. In fact, he'd be concerned about someone who was so cold-hearted toward his family that he could leave on short notice without even saying goodbye, right? In fact, we're commanded to honor our father and mother. He had a duty to do that. And yet, once again, Jesus' reply to this guy is a rebuke. And in fact, this is actually the strongest rebuke of any of these three. Here again, he stresses the single-mindedness that he demands of his disciples, his followers. Verse 62, Jesus said to him, "No one who puts his hand to the plow and looks back is fit for the kingdom of God." See, a plowman who looks backward can't cut a straight furrow. It makes it crooked. Plowing is a simple task, but it requires great concentration on the work and a constant forward look. Those whose hearts aren't in it make poor plowmen. So, and in fact, let me ask you this. What does the idea of one who looks back, what does that remind you of biblically? It makes me think of Lot's wife, who looked back because she was reluctant to leave Sodom. And in that one moment of hesitation, her judgment caught up with her. She was turned to a pillar of salt. And apparently there was still that kind of hint of worldly affection in this guy's heart, and Jesus knew it. So he gives him a rebuke rather than permission. No doubt this man's attachment to his family was something more than it appears on the surface. Of course, Jesus knew what he was thinking. Perhaps this guy knew his family would try to dissuade him from following Christ. He's looking for an excuse to spend some time with them before he makes his final commitment, secretly hoping that maybe they would give him a good reason to turn back and not follow Christ after all, like he wants to be talked out of it. In fact, the Greek expression here is a little bit complex, and it implies that this man is asking for something more than a simple goodbye to his family and friends. It's a reflexive verb, which literally, in other words, means, let me first withdraw myself from matters at home. Like the second guy, he may have had the idea that he needed to defer following Christ until he had spent some time getting his affairs in order, or whatever. In any case, Jesus, we know, could see directly into this man's heart, and it's clear from the answer he gave the man that the man was actually undecided about following Christ, and his plea was really nothing more than an excuse for delay. People do this all the time, right? They say, "I'm going to do this," because they want the commendation or the praise, when in fact they really have no intention of doing what they say they're going to do. That's what these guys were doing. Jesus knew that. And so Jesus calls this man to obey immediately, because the work of the kingdom must take priority over everything, including family. Matthew 10, 37 and 38. Remember, whoever loves father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. And whoever loves son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. And whoever does not take his cross and and follow me is not worthy of me. And in the case of each one of these three would-be disciples, Jesus basically gave them similar answers, saying he would tolerate no delay, no double-mindedness, no lukewarmness, no excuses. That's the nature of Christ's call to discipleship.